Hi,
my name is Maciek. I work in the IntelliJ Scala team at JetBrains, and this is the first video in a new series where we talk about how IntelliJ IDEA can help you with your Scala development. We will discuss essential IDE features, solutions to common problems, and tips to improve your productivity. In this video, we will guide you through how to install IntelliJ IDEA with Scala, create a new project, work with an existing project, run and debug applications, and give you a quick look at additional features.
You can install IntelliJ IDEA directly from JetBrains.com IDEA download or through the JetBrains Toolbox app. I recommend the Toolbox app as it will handle all the updates later on and allow you to download other JetBrains products. If you have already installed IntelliJ IDEA and want to add Scala support, you'll need to download and enable the Scala plugin. From the Welcome screen, select Plugins, then open the Marketplace tab, find the Scala plugin, click Install, and restart the IDE if prompted. Otherwise, if you already work with IntelliJ IDEA and have a product opened, one in Java, let's say, press Command and comma to open settings and select plugins from there. That's it. We can now create a new Scala project from the welcome screen or by opening the top menu and choosing File, New, Project. From the list on the left, select Scala and name the new project and change its location if necessary. If you want to place the new project under version control, select the Create Git Repository checkbox. If you decide not to, you can do it later. Next, choose whether to use the SBT or the IntelliJ build system. Depending on which one you select, you will see different options below. The latter is a native builder and we will use it now. We will come back to SBT in a moment.
The wizard lets you select the JDK if you need to, but usually the default one should be okay. In case you need to set up a different one, or let's say you're just getting started and there is nothing on the list, you can choose Download JDK and then specify Java version and the vendor. IntelliJ IDEA will download it to the given folder.
Similarly, you can select the SDK you want to use in your project from the Scala SDK list. If the desired SDK is not on the list, select Create. A new window will open with a list of Scala SDKs available locally. If this is your first time creating a Scala project, the list will probably be empty. In that case, or if you need an SDK that's not present on the list, select Download and choose the Scala version you need. IntelliJ IDEA will then download it for you. If you want, enable the Add Sample Code option to create a file with a sample Hello World application. Let's do this now. Finally, click Create. IntelliJ IDEA will now generate a simple project for you. Since we chose Scala 3 in the wizard, the project consists of a single main Scala file with the main method. You can see it here in the editor. You will find the project view with the file tree to the left. If you click the crosshair icon, the tree will unfold to show the file currently opened in the editor. You can run the app by pressing Ctrl and R, or clicking the Run icon in the editor gutter, or clicking the same icon in the top bar. Since this is a simple text-based application, IntelliJ IDEA will open the console and display the app's results there. Now, let's quickly go back to the wizard. This time, we will create a new project with SBT as our build system.
SBT is the default build tool for Scala, used to compile Scala code, run tests, and manage dependencies. In the past, the name SBT stood for Scala Build Tool or Simple Build Tool. Nowadays, it's treated as a proper name.
Most steps in this procedure are the same as before. The difference is only in that after switching to an SBT project, you can choose the SBT version and then the Scala version. By default, the Scala version is set to the latest minor version of the Scala 3.3 LTS.
You can also download the source code for both SBT and Scala, which might be helpful if your work requires you to check the implementation details, or if you need easy access to Scala standard library documentation, which is probably a more common use case.
This time though, let's select the checkbox for generating code with onboarding tips. It's a new feature for beginners that makes it easier to start using IntelliJ IDEA with Scala. Now, if I click Create, IntelliJ IDEA will generate a slightly more complex project than before.
You can see, of course, that it contains the build SBT and build properties files. Build properties contains only one line that specifies the SBT version I chose in the wizard. Build SBT is only a bit larger. There's a customary initial 0.1.0 snapshot version set, then the Scala version I chose, and then the build definition with only one project. The name of the project is the one I gave to it. Now let's switch to main Scala. That file is a bit different than before.
It contains more code than before, as well as onboarding tips. Those are those special comments with embedded icons and shortcuts. The first one tells us how to run the program. The second one confirms this highlighted code, 1 to 5 map println. Since println returns unit, IntelliJ IDEA advises us to change map to for each. Also, the onboarding tip mentions that we can use option plus return on Mac to see other possible actions. Remember that shortcut, option plus return, you will use it very often. The last tip is about breakpoints and running the program in debugging mode. If we do that, for example by pressing Ctrl and D, the program will run up to the breakpoint and there it will pause.
On the left in the debug view, you can see the stack trace. And on the right, the values of fields and variables in the scope of the place where the program paused.
Here we have a range of numbers, 1 to 5, and the for loop runs through them. We have a breakpoint inside the loop, however, so we paused at number 1. If we resume the program, it will print a line with the number 1, then the loop will run again for the number 2 and pause at the breakpoint, and so on.
There are many features in IntelliJ IDEA that can help you edit your code effectively. For example, you have a wide range of refactoring tools available to you from the pop-up menu, as well as from the context actions through shortcuts. I will use one of those tools now to extract that line with print line here to its own method.
I click right to open the pop-up menu, choose refactor, and then extract method. As you can see, I can also use a shortcut. On my Mac, it's option plus command plus M. Now, IntelliJ IDEA asks me where the extracted method should be created. I think it should be just the file level. And I can give it a name, and as you can see, IntelliJ IDEA already correctly guessed that it would have one parameter, I, which is an integer, and that it would return a unit. Let's create it. Okay. I did it because now I can run the debugger and show you how when it stops at the breakpoint, I can use the step into action to move the program just one step further and into that method, the one I've just created. I can then step over, meaning going to the following line, or step out, that is, jump out from the method to the one that called it. In our case, both actions mean the same, as this new print method has only one line. On top of those two ways of creating a new project from scratch, you can import a project from your version control system, select File, New, Project from Version Control, and provide the necessary data. IntelliJ IDEA will download and set up the project for you. Let's do that now. We will download a small open source library I maintain. It's small but more significant than that trivial Hello World program we saw before. It consists of several source code files divided into packages. In some files there is more than one Scala class or trait. Inside one class there are many fields and methods. To navigate such big files, press Command and 7 and open the structure view on the left. It shows the contents of the file you currently have open in the editor as a tree of nested elements. Another way is to press Command and F12. It will open the structure view in a pop-up window, and if you press Command and F12 again, you will be able to see the inherited members of the class as well. So, in the signal Scala file, we have the signal class with lots of methods. There's also the signal companion object, and inside it, there's a private class that has its own methods. A larger, more complex project, such as this, lets us show off more IntelliJ IDEA features than a Hello World program. For example, if classes have their Scala doc comments, we can see that documentation by hovering over the field of a given class. We can look up the type information of every field, and since the type is known, IntelliJ IDEA can help us write code by displaying fields and methods available for a class instance. And by the way, if our project contains tests, IntelliJ IDEA can recognize and run them.
You can run all tests simultaneously, those in a given folder, just one class of tests, or just one specific test. If you do, and the test fails, you can also set breakpoints and rerun the test in the debug mode. This way, you will see what production code is being called by the test and use the step interaction we have already discussed to track what is happening. In the upcoming videos, we will discuss these and many more features in more detail. Like and subscribe so you won't miss them.
Happy developing!